I've been getting more and more into video, and I decided that the background on the plug meetings sort of suck, so I want to put my own backgrounds on. So, well, I have a hanger thing for other photo stuff, but I bought the green part, and I've been playing with that and learning a lot. So I came to tell you what I've learned. So basically, the technical name for this is actually chroma keying. Chroma being a Greek word for color. Essentially what you are doing is a notch filter for your video, your photo, whatever. You're isolating one particular color and telling it to do something with that, whether it be, you know, replace it directly or make it transparent so something else shows through. What you want is, doesn't matter what color it is. It'll be interesting to find out if Hans has two little stripes when we do the video later because of his green sleeves. I don't think he will because it's a little bit off color, but the things you want is you want it to be as even as possible. You want it to be a color that nobody's got on. And so this green tends to be a color that people don't generally wear. Yes? Yes, they do. To some extent. Depending on how good your system is, you can actually incorporate the shadows in. It'll take the color out and leave just a little bit of darkening that will go on to something else. But, ideally you would want like 4 or 6 lights just on the background of this to light this perfectly even. I don't have enough money and I don't want to have to set up that much stuff, so I went with 2 lights. They're also lighting the person because we tend to turn the lights off in here. And I've learned the hard way that when the lights go off on here, I might as well just film the screen because the presenter just goes away. So I'm hoping this will work. It's a little bit distracting, but it's not terrible. Anyway, I will start off with the still stuff. So I am a big GIMP guy. That's the first thing I reached for. When I started playing with this, let me get this the right size. Oops. So, and I actually quickly learned the GIMP is actually really terrible at this. But let me show you a few tricks. These aren't exclusively for doing this type of stuff, so they're kind of fun. And I moved it. Okay, so for about a day when I shot this, and as you can see, it comes wrinkled. Iron it before you use it. That's all I'll say. When I went to start dropping out the background, all the little wrinkles were a pain. It keeps changing the tone of the screen. The actual creases themselves are hard to get rid of. And so iron your screens and then store them in such a way. If you can roll them, that's the way to go. If not, I did notice on Amazon the number one thing that was bought along with the green screen was a steam iron. So, let's get this down to the side. So anyway, first thing that most people will reach for on this is the color select tool, which is up here. The little 3 colors. And it basically allows you to just select a color range. If you double click it, you can actually get some stuff, whether you want anti-alias or you want a hard edge, whether to feather it or whatnot. And so you can just click close by. You know, that's obviously not enough, so let's crank up the threshold here and keep clicking, play through this threshold some more. Too much. Okay. The cool part is if you hold down shift, you can actually just keep clicking farther and farther out, and it will grow, but this holds way too high. So anyway, you're not going to get it perfect. And if I actually, let me delete that. Okay. And you can, if I zoom in here, you can see the problem with that. I still have green around my hair. It didn't fade it in or anything like that. If I were to put anything behind this, there would that be an obvious green outline to me. Yeah. So it's not the tool for the job. You can play with this feathering, but that just says to feather a certain amount of your selection, period. And so all it'll do is kind of blend your edges in no matter what. So if you've got it, if it does go crisp along your shoulder or something like that, now it's going to fade your shoulder into the background. So it's not, it's a very useful tool, but it's not here. So the second tool I reached for was, what is this? Under color to alpha. And for this, you tend to need to uncheck this preview box, which can't even see because I'm seeing. So the preview box here. Uncheck that until you can get your pure color. Click your eyedropper and do the same thing. Click it next to, oh, I'll actually do it close to the hair so you can get closing. And then go preview. And this does a little bit better job, but if you see, it's actually untransparent myself. There's no settings for it. There's no threshold or anything like that. So you get what you get. You know, you can play with, you know, various selection areas. You know, maybe click here instead. And see if it does any better. But it seems to, instead of going through and finding, okay, this is really close to this actual color, it's actually going through and saying, okay, well, all colors are made of green. They're just mixtures and stuff. So all, you know, there's some, even though the shirt's maroon, it's got some green in it, so I'll just take that green out. And so that's not really what you want either. So the last thing I went for was, it's a little bit more difficult trick, and it gives you the best result. You actually want to double up your image here. And then basically what we're going to do is we're going to try. Picture. And so, essentially you need to come into the components where you can actually come in and play with the individual colors. And we're going to do monochrome. Usually check off the preserve luminosity. And they've changed this interface recently. It used to be just three bars, and now it's six. It must have something to do with 16-bit stuff. But I found on this, only the top three matter. So basically, you just kind of have to play with it and see if you can get these things to... that's kind of close to what we're looking for there, actually. So anyway, you can see I've got it masked off fairly well. So if I click OK there, I'll do a Control A to select all, copy, and then we'll add a layer mask. And it doesn't matter what that is, and we will paste the layer mask on there and hit the enter it. So, okay. And boop. Best result yet. And you zoom in here. It's still not great, but it's done better things with my hair. This is actually a fuzzy image. It's not actually a very good, sample, but it's still better. What's that? Yeah, it's my fault. I didn't focus my camera before I took my own picture. But anyway, you can see that it's, the edges are pretty clean, a little bit of nastiness in the armpit. But that's about the best you're going to get out of GIMP that I found. And you can get a little bit better with that if you take a little bit more time creating your mask. But did everyone see how I did that or care? But, if you don't know, that basically the... the picture that's showing, and then the one to the right is the mask, and black is all the way transparent, white is all the way show what the image is. And so I basically just pulled it to be transparent where it matched, or where I forced everything to black. So, okay. If there's no questions, I'll go on to the next program. So interestingly enough, just for kicks, I was having a really hard time with that. And I don't usually go for Krita, and this thing has totally won me over. I am going to be diving into Krita like crazy for this. At least was, I don't know if still is part of the KDE Office suite. It's kind of a competitor to GIMP, but not really at the same time. It does a lot of what GIMP does, but it's their main focus is for people to do hand drawings and stuff. So most of the stuff you see coming out of GIMP, it looks very natural, like somebody drew it. But it's got some really, really nice tools, and it does stuff a little bit differently. And most important, the reason I always kind of kept going back to it, it understands at least 16-bit color. And so the only reason I actually tried it is I accidentally opened up a raw image on my camera, and it opened in 3D. I went, eh, I'll play with it for a few minutes, and ran across this. That's not what that is. Okay. It's chopping off the whole bottom, but it won't let me change it. So, anyway, I just sort of stumbled across. So you go just filter color to alpha, and it's then it's the same thing as the GIMP. You need to uncheck your preview, and then it by default has the little eyedropper. You know, select your color close to what matters the most, which is usually going to be your hair or whatnot, and then recheck your preview. And you can see it kind of did the same thing as GIMP did, but it has a threshold. So you can sit there and play with it until it looks really nice. And right there, I would call that really nice. You can see on the edges, it gets darker. That's because I don't have enough light. So, but the lighting is pretty normal. Huh, it looks different on here than this here. Let's see. Well, mine shows it transparent on my screen. I don't know why it's a giant hot spot in the middle on here, but I'm going to press OK. And then if I zoom in here, you can see it's done a much, much better job with the hair. It's still a fuzzy image, so you can't see the individual hairs, but I've done it with nice, crisp images. And you could indeed see, you know, it doesn't have the armpit problems. You know, a little bit of fading on the side is okay, especially on a blurry image. It'll more naturally go in to something else. But, so anyway, I think, I still may end up using GIMP for most of my stuff, or I may bounce this type of stuff through Krita really quick. Just put it in here and then use a file format like PNG or TIFF or something like that. It allows for an alpha channel, which is the transparency. Save it like that, then pull it into the GIMP, and then I can do whatever the heck I want with it, and very easily. So, any questions on that? Krita with a K, K-R-I-T-A. Uh-huh. Yeah. And that's always been Krita. What's that? Sure. I'm sure there's an easier way to do this, but I'll figure out. Ta-da! Oops, I've got transparency on my stomach. But you actually can go in with Krita. They have some stuff where you can do levels directly on the alpha channel, so you could actually save. Make the transparent stuff more transparent, and the stuff that's not quite, shove it to more, you know, do a curve on it, basically, and get rid of that as well. But, yeah, that, it went pretty well, and, like, I would come through here and erase the edges and stuff. You know, most of the hard work's been done by the system itself. So, okay. Okay. And now for the reason I actually bought it. So my video editor of choice is Kdenlive, probably no surprise to most people in here. It's what I use to edit all the videos I do in here. I'm still deciding if I'm going to bring this every time or not, but I might just get the quality up a little bit. And I was ideally, I was hoping to have a presentation from Plug to do the presentation to Plug with. And it didn't work out that way. So anyway, let me add a couple clips in here. Okay. So the first thing I learned the hard way on this thing is when you're working with high def and Kdenlive, it does something kind of cool, but kind of bit me in the butt without me realizing it. Because it's really hard for it to show in real time, high def stuff. It'll look at your clips that you pull and go like, oh, that's in high def. Let me downscale that for you so the editing will be nice and quick. Very, very cool. Makes editing life nice. But when you start playing with your green screen stuff, it's such a harsh encoding that you've got all sorts of little jaggies and stuff, and you're looking at your video going like, man, why can't I just get that green screen to go right up to the shirt or whatnot? And so I found that you need to right-click on your clip just for the green screen setup and uncheck proxy clip. And you can tell, when proxy clip's on, it'll have a little P in the corner. So just when you uncheck that, make sure the P's not there. And then it will do real-time or as close as it can high-def stuff, and stuff will look good. So to do this, we need some video and a background. And it calls it a transition. By default, it doesn't affine transition. It just needs to be something that'll composite. A fine will composite. I'm going to switch it out and actually put a composite one. It doesn't really matter. So anyway, I'm not actually in this scene, so now I am. So the first thing you need to do is go find the chroma key, which is not called chroma key. It's called blue screen, so it doesn't have to be blue. So you just basically hit it with the eyedropper here. Same thing, click your hair, and you're instantly good. And you can see it does pretty good. Because I don't have the very good lighting, but I stand in the middle for most of this clip, I would go through and mask off the sides. And so it just, basically force the transparency on the side. In fact, we could probably do that real quick. So gone. And you could just hold that for the whole thing. You can see now when I walk on it comes from the mask. So let me start to. So if I turn on the proxy clip again, not actually looking quite as bad as it did the other day. Must have got a better color, but when the proxy clip was on before, it was an obvious green area around the sides and stuff. It was driving me nuts. Another problem you'll have both with still photography and video is I've mostly seen it referred to as spill color. And basically what that is, and you get that when I stand closer, the green, black, very well, but when the light hits, it actually casts some green off of the green screen. And so this is actually not, for me, it's not lit too bad, but I've seen some bad footage out on the net where it's just, you can't really see it until you drop the background out. You're like, oh my gosh, that guy's green on the side. And they have a thing for that as well. If you you just have to go to your effects and alpha manipulation, and they have one called key spill mop-up. And it's the same thing. You pick your color, You'd have to turn off your background and everything so you could get that pure color again, and then you give it a rough color of what it's supposed to be. And it doesn't really matter that much. It just has to be kind of close, and it just magically goes away. It's really nice. And so as I was a little frustrated while I was waiting for my screen to come in the mail, I went and just grabbed some random images and videos just to play with it. And I was like, man, I got green. How do I get rid of that? And after a little research, I stumbled across that. That's been really nice. The other thing I found is that you'll have times when you just can't quite make it work right. And they have yet another thing in here all of this is under alpha manipulations, but they have alpha operations. And let's close these down. Okay, so now we have four things going all at once. So basically the operation is you can say, okay, well, I have my alpha channel, and in this case, order matters. You know, if you do this thing first, there's no alpha channel for it to work on. So it needs to establish the alpha, the transparency, and then hit it with this. So you can basically say, take the alpha channel and shrink it softly. And that'll basically go through and just kind of feather the edges. So if you just can't make it work, it's bad video or something like that, you know, you're not going to fix it. You can at least go through and shrink it just a little bit and make it fuzzy, and it'll blend in. It's not going to be perfect, but it's going to be better than a hard green edge or blue edge or whatever you got around the edge. So, any questions on that one? So, okay, last but not least then, just for Larry. Because if he was in the audience, he would be saying, hey, I'll bring out Openshot. That was his favorite editor, although I think I had him pretty well won over to Kdenlive. I just jumped into this long enough. I'm not a big fan of Kdenlive. It's great for tiny stuff, but maybe try to do something fancy, it kind of falls on its face, I found. Let's see. Well, Openshot does, sorry. Getting lights off. And getting off somewhere. I'll show you. Okay. So anyway, there's the video. So this is under effects, and the one thing they have going for it is they actually call it Chroma Key, which is right. So anyway, if I add the Chroma Key on there, and where'd it go? Okay. So here's where I think this sucks, is I've got my effect stack here. And and my key color. So it's not a big deal. I can select it. So, and then I have my variance. This is where that slider was on pretty much everything else. And basically, it's kind of a fire and hope you got it. And then if it doesn't work, go back in, fire, hope you got it. And so it's kind of a pain. So it's, you know, 0.10 to start off with. I didn't see it. Hit it really hard enough, then nothing's happening. Yay! It should be working. Okay, well, it worked perfectly early tonight. So, anyway, it does work. It can get nice results out of it, but it's really hard to tweak it to get it perfect. You can't just hit the slider and instantly see what's happening. You have to change it, hit apply. Oh crap, that's not it. Go back, change it, hit apply, go back, and over and over again. That made me switch to Kdenlive, mostly for like zooming pictures, because the zooming pictures was like, put in the percentage of how big it wants to be and the number of where you want to place it. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to be able to just move it and then and move it somewhere else. Have a go. So, anyway, that's that's what I've learned so far on this. And hopefully it'll make for some nice floating head presentations in the future. Or at least some make it look like we're giving presentations from some really nice areas. Oh, absolutely, yeah. You can stack these things. You could have video of several different people on green screen, stack all those up, and make them all look like they're sitting at the same table, and then slap a video background on that. One thing I did forget to mention that is very, very important, have your background in mind before you shoot your shot, because you need to pay attention to how you light it, if you look in the background, like on that beach scene, there's a palm tree and the shadows are obviously going this way. Now, if I've got my hotter light going this way, it's going to look really unnatural. It's going to stick out like a sore thumb because obviously I'm being lit completely wrong to the scene. So, anyway, that's one. So, anyway, that's all I got. Thank you.